In this video, I'm going to tell you how to use an extract from the brains of pigs to rehabilitate your brain, reduce symptoms of anxiety and depression, to inhibit withdrawals from drugs, to delay tolerance from drugs, and to delay the progression of neurodegenerative disease. But before I do, please subscribe to this channel, like the video if you haven't already, and comment on the video for the sake of the algorithm. Now let's get started. Now a little bit of background. How did I come across Cerebrolysin? Well, two things happened to me in my life that required me to research psychological rehabilitation. One was that I had an essential tremor from childhood. That means that my hands used to shake from the age of about 9 or 10. And this essential tremor worsened in my 20s when I experienced further brain damage. Second, I developed almost crippling anxiety in my early 20s and spent years trying to rehabilitate myself from it. In my efforts to rehabilitate myself from these two conditions, I discovered that pharmacologic intervention that increased growth factor synthesis in the brain and therefore increased what's called plasticity in the brain. Plasticity meaning your brain's ability to reorganize itself due to the presence of growth factors. I found that these pharmacologic interventions were the most effective at healing my anxiety disorder, and while doing so, they surprisingly almost entirely healed my essential tremor. As I became very interested in these results, I spent a great deal of time studying other neurotrophic compounds, and that's why I have my extremely exhaustive series on the serotonin system. Now, Cerebrolysin is one of the only commercially readily available preparations of neurotrophic compounds. When I discovered it, I experimented with it so much that I believe I may be the single individual in the world who has most used Cerebrolysin. In this video, I'll tell you what Cerebrolysin is. I'll then tell you some of its major consistent effects before I review some of the most interesting rodent studies on Cerebrolysin. And finally, I review the extensive human studies on Cerebrolysin. After I do that, I'm going to tell you how I personally got my Cerebrolysin and how I think Cerebrolysin is best used. In 1949, Gerhard Harrer found out that enzymatic hydrolysis of brain tissues produced a substance that activated nerve cells. By 1954, this substance was registered as a drug in Austria. It was called FPF-1070. Since then, the drug, now come to be known as Cerebrolysin, has been used extensively in East Asia and Eastern Europe, though it has yet to gain popularity in Western Europe and North America. Cerebrolysin is a protein-based mixture of free amino acids and low molecular weight active amino acids containing actual growth factors for the brain from pigs, including brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which is the main growth factor that SSRIs work around, nerve growth factor, glial cell-derived neurotrophic factor, and ciliary neurotrophic factor. Now, all of these growth factors are actually the growth factors of pigs, but they share a amino acid homology with humans such that they actually bind to and activate the same receptors in our bodies. Now, before we begin reviewing the literature on Cerebrolysin, I want to alert you to the fact that I have a summary blog post that will be linked in the description section below, where you can find all the citations that I refer to in this discussion. I would have put them up on the video like I normally do, except there's just way too many citations and it would be prohibitively time consuming. So you guys can visit the link in the blog below, visit the blog post. It's very well organized. It's not a text heavy thing, and you can easily visit the citations there. Now let's get started reviewing the consistent effects that we see from Cerebrolysin in rodent and human studies. First of all, Cerebrolysin treatment not only activates the growth factor receptors by actually bringing in the pig growth factors into the human body, but Cerebrolysin treatment actually increases the serum levels of brain-derived neurotrophic factor endogenously, of nerve growth factor, and even of IGF-1. Second, Cerebrolysin consistently produces an anti-inflammatory effect on humans and animals. It consistently lowers markers of inflammatory cytokines like tumor necrosis factor alpha and improves markers of oxidative stress and glutathione activity, thereby protecting neurons from damage. Third, like donepezil, a drug given to Alzheimer's disease patients, and lithium, Cerebrolysin modulates the activity of glycogen synthase kinase 3, which is also called glucosynthase kinase 3, GSK3. Cerebrolysin's inhibition of glycogen synthase kinase B and cyclin-dependent kinase 5 is the reason, it appears, that cerebrolysin inhibits the development of beta amyloid plaques, which are characteristic of Alzheimer's disease, and the phosphorylation of tau proteins, which is also characteristic of Alzheimer's disease. The end results are that cerebrolysin induces plastic changes to the brain, particularly in dendritic morphology. For example, cerebrolysin increases dendritic spine density as well as dendritic volume in the pyramidal neurons of the prefrontal cortex as well as in the dentate gyrus. Cerebrolysin reverses endothelial permeability dysfunction also by reducing procoagulation proteins and pro-inflammatory proteins and by increasing tight junction proteins. So that's a summary of the consistent effects that we see of cerebrolysin across animal studies and human studies. Now what I want to do next is I want to take you on a tour of some of the more interesting animal studies that have not sort of that have unique applications that have not been tested out yet in humans. So let's begin with a couple of models of cognitive deficits, beginning with diabetes and then aging-related cognitive deficits. In a rodent model of diabetes-induced cognitive decline, cerebrolysin treatment actually attenuated body weight loss due to diabetes, attenuated HbA1c elevations due to the diabetes, which means blood sugar elevations due to the diabetes. It attenuated learning and memory loss due to the diabetes. It attenuated increases in inflammatory cytokines. It actually lowered tumor necrosis factor alpha in these diabetic rodents. And it increased IGF-1 beta, serotonin levels, and glutamate levels. The authors concluded that cerebrolysin may be neuroprotective against diabetes-induced cognitive decline. In a rodent model of aging-related cognitive decline, cerebrolysin treatment dose-dependently reduced oxidative stress markers, improved learning and memory, and reduced apoptosis, which means the death of cells in the brain. Now let's take a tour through some of the Parkinson's disease models and the use of cerebrolysin in them. There are two very well-known Parkinson's disease models in rodent studies using two different poisons that damage dopaminergic neurons in the brain, simulating the development of Parkinson's disease. In the 6-OHDA model of Parkinson's disease in rodents, cerebrolysin post-treatment, not even pre-treatment, but post-treatment after the rodents endured the poison, improved, for example, dopamine levels in the midbrain and striatum, normalized MDA and NO levels, and increased glutathione levels in the midbrain. In the MPTP model of Parkinson's disease, sustained release nanoparticles of cerebrolysin produced a similar effect as in the last model that we covered. Fascinatingly, in a rodent model of ethanol exposure, concurrent treatment with cerebrolysin normalized oxidative stress markers and apoptosis from ethanol, which means using cerebrolysin, for example, in humans, if one were to go out drinking one night, if one injected cerebrolysin just before going out drinking, it's possible that the cerebrolysin may lower oxidative stress markers in the brain and across the body, actually, and reduce death of neurons in the brain from alcohol. As some of you may know, alcohol in the long term can produce a particular kind of brain damage, and in the short term, it does damage neurons in the brain, mostly due to excitotoxicity, I think, as well as the oxidative stress and inflammation in the body. Now, before I talk about the rodent model of morphine withdrawal, I'd like to mention something personal. So as those of you who watch Derek and Steve and I's podcast will know, while I was experimenting with cerebrolysin myself, I had a consultation client who I spoke with who was suffering through opiate dependency. I had suggested that the use of cerebrolysin may be helpful in acclimating this person to his new lifestyle after ceasing his use of the opiates. Why? The reason was because drug use tends to produce plasticity in the brain. And one of my theories of the reasons why it's so difficult to quit using drugs is that when one quits using drugs as an adult, they return to a very frigid brain that is not flexible and not adaptable to their new environment. So usually people would like to use something like antidepressants to produce this plasticity. But antidepressants take quite a while to work. Cerebrolysin doesn't. And that's why I had been considering using it myself and for others in cases of urgent need for neurogenesis. So I suggested to this consultation client that he may find value in cerebrolysin after he quits using opiates. And now I leave the discovery up to this client. Instead of using it after he quit using opiates, he had failed to quit a couple of times and was having great difficulty. So when he actually did use the cerebrolysin, what he did was use it across the days in which he was titrating down his dose of opiates, and through a couple of days of the withdrawal. And he discovered that the cerebrolysin inhibited his withdrawal. Now, I had a feeling that this might happen because I had previously had a lot of experience with the drug ibogaine. And I had been trying to understand how ibogaine could inhibit opiate withdrawal. It was quite difficult to understand. I have a video on my channel in which I reviewed the scientific literature on ibogaine and concluded that it's most likely the lasting increase in neurogenesis that somehow inhibits the opiate withdrawal. But I didn't know how this happens molecularly or whether it was true. Afterwards, after my client tried this and several other people tried it, we found that in most cases, except in extremely strong cases of opioid dependency, concurrent cerebrolysin treatment appeared to limit the withdrawal that people experience. Now, after all that, I discovered that there are actually rodent studies showing that this does happen. So let's review those. In a rodent model of morphine withdrawal, pre-treatment with cerebrolysin inhibited some of the withdrawal symptoms, attenuated the increase in heat shock proteins, but did not limit affect tolerance with the opiates. This is a little contradictory because there is another study on opiate withdrawal and tolerance that shows that concurrent use of cerebrolysin in rodents not only attenuated the withdrawal symptoms, but also delayed the tolerance development from the opiate. Fascinatingly, cerebrolysin can also be used to attenuate the memory deficits that come from sleep deprivation. Rodent studies show that the acute memory deficits that come from sleep deprivation can be attenuated with cerebrolysin, likely due to effects directly at the hippocampus of reducing oxidative stress to it. Now, we'll just go through a few more models of depression, pain, hyperthermia, meaning when people are too hot or have a heat stress, and finally, schizophrenia. Now, in a rodent model of reserpine-induced depression, which is a kind of rodent model of depression that has a low activity of monoamines in the rodent's brains. Monoamines are serotonin, norepinephrine, dopamine, and those kind of hormones. In that rodent model, pre-treatment with cerebrolysin increased the levels of serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine, increased brain-derived neurotrophic factor, reduced tumor necrosis factor alpha, which is a pro-inflammatory cytokine, and improved antioxidant status. Further, it actually improved depressive symptoms to a similar degree as fluoxetine, which is Prozac. Next, in a rodent model of mechanical neuropathic pain, cerebrolysin treatment was effective at reducing the mechanical neuropathic pain, but not the peripheral inflammation associated with it. Now, hyperthermia models basically study heat stroke. In a rodent model of hyperthermia, cerebrolysin pre-treatment attenuated reductions in the blood-brain barrier permeability and reduced overall neuronal damage due to the heat. In a later review paper studying the use of cerebrolysin for heat strokes, the authors concluded that cerebrolysin is the best neuroprotective compound available for heat strokes. Finally, in a rodent model of schizophrenia, which is maybe the most severe mental disorder that humans experience, 30-day treatment with cerebrolysin was effective at attenuating the pathology of dendrites in the schizophrenic brains, specifically reducing dendritic spine loss, reducing dendritic retraction, and generally improving the symptoms of dendritic pathology. Further, the cerebrolysin treatment also reduced amphetamine-induced locomotion. What that means is there's a hypothesis of schizophrenia that attributes schizophrenia to dysregulated dopamine signaling. So using an amphetamine, they sometimes test how rodents respond to the amphetamine. If they over-respond to the amphetamine, they know that the rodents have more dysregulated dopamine signaling. So it seems that in the case of schizophrenics, cerebrolysin normalized this dopamine signaling to some degree. Whereas in other studies, you can see that cerebrolysin also normalized the dopamine by increasing it. In this case, it seems to have decreased it in some way. It also improved social activity of the schizophrenic rodents and attenuated neuronal loss in the prefrontal cortex and nucleus accumbens. The authors concluded that cerebrolysin may be an effective add-on treatment for schizophrenics. Next, I'm going to review actual human studies using cerebrolysin across the various pathologies that it's been used for. I'll try to be brief in my summaries here because I've written a bit more detail on my blog in case you guys desire more detail, and then you can visit the papers themselves as well. Let's begin with diabetic neuropathy. Diabetic neuropathy is a kind of nerve dysfunction that comes with diabetes, involving peripheral nerve pain usually. In a 1997 placebo-controlled longitudinal study, 20 diabetics who were given 20 milliliters of cerebrolysin for 10 days in a row found reductions in diabetic neuropathy pain for at least 6 weeks following the treatment. Next, let's look at vascular dementia, which is the second most common dementia and is caused by a disordered blood flow to the brain, which causes cognitive impairment over the long term. In particular, let's review the Cochrane meta-analysis. For those that don't know, Cochrane is a kind of meta-analysis organization that is very reliable. They do meta-analyses on various subjects in academia. I don't really know where they're centered, actually, but I frequently read their meta-analyses. Anyway, this Cochrane meta-analysis was produced in 2013 and again updated in 2019. And it included 6 randomized controlled trials using cerebrolysin, using different doses, actually. 4 of the trials used cerebrolysin once a day, 5 days a week for 4 weeks, while 2 of the trials used a much longer duration of up to 24 weeks. The authors concluded that cerebrolysin improves cognitive function in vascular dementia in a dose and duration dependent fashion, and that effect sizes may be limited by study designs. In particular, the study designs are very short acting. And if one can consider the pathology of dementia, it is a lifetime disease, almost like cardiovascular disease, in which over time, neuroinflammation and neuronal loss in the brain produces dementia. So if one were to think about it, cerebrolysin is mostly neuroprotective. If one were to use cerebrolysin over a much longer period, the effect sizes may be much greater. For example, I would speculate that it may seriously attenuate the development of vascular dementia and other dementias. There are many randomized controlled trials of cerebrolysin use in human patients with Alzheimer's disease. And in my blog post, you'll find them reviewed in quite a bit of detail. Here, I'm going to summarize some of the major learning outcomes of them. First of all, consistently, cerebrolysin treatment is shown to be dose-dependently and duration-dependently effective at improving clinical outcomes of Alzheimer's disease, which means, you know, the clinicians have certain tests that they use to judge how the person is performing. Consistently, cerebrolysin improves their performance. But there are some interesting details about this. For example, some studies used widely varying doses, like up to 60 milliliters a day. And even those studies found that even at that dose, not only was cerebrolysin extremely safe, but at 60 milliliters, the effect size continued to increase such that there is a truly dose-dependent effect up to 60 milliliters, at least in Alzheimer's disease patients. So another effect found was that while cerebrolysin could independently increase brain-derived neurotrophic factor and reduce tumor necrosis factor alpha and other things like that, its effect was potentiated when it was combined with the Alzheimer's disease drug donepezil, which many of you know I take. It's an acetylcholesterase inhibitor. It's sort of like the pharmacologic version of some of the supplements we have in the Gorilla Mind product. So when you inhibit acetylcholesterase, it seems that it potentiates, at least in Alzheimer's disease patients, the effects of cerebrolysin, increasing their duration and their effect size. Interestingly, the effect of cerebrolysin on brain-derived neurotrophic factor in the Alzheimer's disease patients trails for at least 3 months after they cease cerebrolysin treatment. Similar to the effects of ibogaine, cerebrolysin has this long-acting effect after usage, which is one of the greatest things about it. Interestingly, the use of donepezil with cerebrolysin could extend that period as well. Two more interesting notes. It seems that ApoE4 carriers benefit more from cerebrolysin treatments among the Alzheimer's disease patients, and the ApoE4 carriers that had higher brain-derived neurotrophic factor levels already benefited the most from the cerebrolysin treatment. By the way, guys, remember we all have 2 copies of either the ApoE4, ApoE3, or ApoE2 gene. They really dramatically influence our cardiovascular health and mental health. If you do not know which gene you carry, you should really get a 23andMe or Ancestry.com test done as soon as possible and discover which one you are. ApoE2 is protective, ApoE3 is the most common variant, and ApoE4 is the ancestral variant that seems to be quite dangerous for Alzheimer's disease and cardiovascular disease. A final note. In markedly ill Alzheimer's disease patients, not the mild to moderate Alzheimer's disease, but the really bad one, in those patients, vascular endothelial growth factor, which is called VEGF, which promotes the growth of new blood vessels in the body, increases. But it seems to increase as a response to the pathology of Alzheimer's disease. Cerebrolysin treatment there can reduce the increases in VEGF, but it seems to do this indirectly by reducing the total pathology of the Alzheimer's disease. Now, one of the most studied applications of cerebrolysin is for traumatic brain injuries. In fact, when I first discovered cerebrolysin, I actually thought it was only studied for traumatic brain injuries. I'll cover a couple of studies here. First of all, a meta-analysis covering all studies prior to 2018 shows a statistically significant improvement in outcomes for patients given cerebrolysin following traumatic brain injury. Interestingly, in 2019, there was a trial called the CAPTAIN-1 randomized control trial of cerebrolysin for just over 40 patients with traumatic brain injuries. In this trial, patients were given 50 milliliters of cerebrolysin a day for 10 days, followed by 10 milliliters a day for 2 more 10-day periods. The patients that were given the treatment fared better than those that didn't. Following this trial, the same authors produced the CAPTAIN 2 randomized control trial with even more patients, almost 140 patients, and that trial confirmed the earlier trial. The authors actually then did a meta-analysis of the two trials to confirm finally that it is certainly the case that cerebrolysin improves outcomes of people who have developed traumatic brain injuries. And interestingly, it was later shown that it does so depending on the age, processing speed, and attention of the person experiencing the TBI, meaning the younger they are, the better they benefit from the cerebrolysin treatment. Now, on this note, I just want to make a side note. You know, it's really interesting that as I get into more interested in the UFC and MMA world, I'm surprised to discover that I have yet to hear from Mike Dolce or anybody else any MMA athlete who uses cerebrolysin in their training or even after fights. I haven't even heard of a doctor giving any of them cerebrolysin treatment after their fights, which would be really opportune and could really save some people's brains, which I consider their souls. You know, it's a really serious thing. In fact, yesterday there was a UFC, I'm recording on a Sunday, so yesterday there was some UFC fights. My wife and I were watching some of them, and I was surprised to see a gentleman who was 37 years old, I can't remember his name exactly, but he fought and got hit a lot in the face during the fight. And I was thinking, this guy suffered some brain damage during the fight, and if only he had cerebrolysin or something to protect himself a little bit afterwards. But when the person at the fight came to interview him, I discovered that he was slurring his words, meaning he already had brain damage, severe traumatic brain damage. And it's shocking that they're letting him fight with that kind of slurring and so on. So anyway, I hope maybe some of you guys watching this video, if you have friends in MMA, you can tell them about cerebrolysin and help maybe save them some neurons. The final human pathology that cerebrolysin has actually been studied in real human trials is a stroke. And there are a couple of kinds of stroke, and there are some mixed results, honestly. In 2012, the largest randomized control trial of cerebrolysin use in stroke victims was performed on over 1,000 patients. Interestingly, unfortunately, the authors were mainly trying to ascertain whether cerebrolysin could improve mortality from strokes, as opposed to neuronal function and so on, or attenuate damage. They did find that if they could stratify, or if they did stratify the patients according to stroke severity, in the patients that experienced the most severe stroke conditions, cerebrolysin treatment did actually improve mortality statistically significantly. But when they did not stratify them, it was no longer a statistically significant effect. Another interesting group of studies occurred between 2015 and 16. They're called the CARS trials. They're randomized control trials of cerebrolysin use in stroke victims. Interestingly, in these trials, what they did was initiate the cerebrolysin treatment quite a bit after the stroke, as opposed to the earlier trials, which tried to basically ascertain the neuroprotective, as opposed to regenerative effects. So if you initiate cerebrolysin, for example, if you do pre-treatment or right around the stroke, you would mostly find, and if it was a short duration treatment, you would mostly notice the effects of the neuroprotection. But in these trials, they initiated the treatment a little bit after, and they continued the treatment for 21 days at a high dose. I think it was 30 milliliters per day. They found that the patients that were given the cerebrolysin treatment recovered dexterity of their upper limbs quicker than the patients that didn't. And this effect was small but consistent across two trials and confirmed by a further meta-analysis in 2017. Unfortunately, the Cochrane review on cerebrolysin for the treatment of strokes, unlike its review for other subjects, does not support the use of cerebrolysin for stroke treatment. But again, I really believe that this is due to the study design. There's such short-term use of the cerebrolysin, and really, I think this may change in the future as cerebrolysin's use becomes more widespread. Recently, though, cerebrolysin was shown to be a beneficial add-on for stroke recovery, in particular because it reduced hemorrhagic complications from the traditional recanalization therapy that's done to stroke victims. Thank you guys for bearing with me through the human trials that were conducted with adults. Now I have to take you through the human trials that were conducted with children, because these really fascinated me. In particular, the safety profile of cerebrolysin has become so evident through these trials. Let me take you through a brief tour of them, beginning with studies on autism. In this section of my blog review, you'll find a characterization of all the studies of cerebrolysin on children with autism. Here, I'll just briefly summarize the results for you. They're consistently showing improvements in qualitative measures of the behavior of autistic children. They've done studies on children as young as 3 years old. They tend to use 0.1 milliliter per kg of intramuscular cerebrolysin used 3 times a week or so. Some of the studies go up to 6 months, all show qualitative improvements in the behavior of autistic children. Now, I was actually surprised by this. I thought that because there's actually a theory of autism. See, autistic children tend to have higher serotonin levels. So there has been a theory of autism considering that the serotonin levels may have been causal in the etiology and pathology of autism, potentially by having too much brain plasticity at a young age. Interestingly, this does not seem to be the case because increasing their brain plasticity seems to improve their conditions. Now, obviously, this is also lowering their inflammatory values and doing other things like that, but it was really surprising to me. Children as young as 3 showing dramatic improvements and an incredible safety profile with the cerebrolysin use. And not even one situation across all of these children's studies, by the way, not even one case of a very bad reaction. Next, let's talk about cerebral palsy. Cerebral palsy is the most common common cause for permanent neurological deficits that happens in children. And it's thought to happen due to some kind of trauma in early life that is not actually progressive. The studies using cerebrolysin on cerebral palsy children begin as early as 1.6 years old. They tend to use, again, 0.1 milliliters per kg. I've written out the dosing schedules for you guys in the blog. Consistently, they show improvements in the qualitative behavior of children with cerebral palsy, dependent on how early they began the treatment. But it doesn't seem to be as much of an improvement as in autistic patients in general. Also note that some of the improvements in cerebral palsy patients last up to 4 months after the cessation of treatment, which is fascinating. It shows true benefits, true changes in the physiology of these cerebral palsy patients. Next, in a fascinating randomized control trial that was Egyptian actually, on preterm infants that were born very young for, they were born early. What they did with these infants was they waited until 6 months after their original intended birth date. Like they were born early, but when they were supposed to be born, 6 months after that, they gave them cerebrolysin treatment. They gave it to them at a low dose, the same 0.1 milliliter per kg, once a week for 3 months, and found that it greatly attenuated motor, learning, and personality difficulties of these preterm infants, despite them being so young when the cerebrolysin treatment was given to them, and also without any major side effects, showing the incredible safety profile of this drug. Now, in this video, I'm going to skip over the next section of my blog post. The next section was a comprehensive review of all of the cerebrolysin treatments on young children with unusual diseases, including idiopathic mental retardation, but many other unusual diseases. I'll leave it to you guys to check that out on the blog post, and we'll move on to the next section here. Now that we've finally finished reviewing the human trials, let's summarize what we learned. The most important thing that I personally learned is the incredible safety profile of cerebrolysin, which I did not fully expect when I initially began using it. We learned that it consistently lowers inflammatory markers, improves antioxidant status in the body, seems to improve many of the pathologies or the results of the pathologies that we've studied. It seems to protect the brain consistently and return the brain to non-pathologic behavior, basically. Now, in this section, the final section of the video, I'm sorry for being so long-winded, but you guys asked for it. A lot of people asked for this detailed video on cerebrolysin. I thought I explained quite a bit about it before, but I thought we'll make this detailed video now. Let's talk about practicality of how I personally have experimented with cerebrolysin. First of all, I bought my cerebrolysin from only one place, which is cosmicnootropic.com. They're actually quite a good organization. I've now bought a lot of cerebrolysin from them over time and for my personal use. And they've also given me a discount code, which you guys can use also. The discount code is Leo. And they sell cerebrolysin, by the way, in ampules. An ampule is like a glass container that contains a liquid inside it. Remember, cerebrolysin is water-based. It's not oil-based like steroids. But it comes in these ampules that are dark, and they come in sizes. On Cosmic Nootropic, you can usually find a 2 milliliter, 5 milliliter, and 10 milliliter ampule size. Now, this matters because the first thing that you have to do when choosing to use cerebrolysin is to decide what dose you're going to use it at. Because it's much more convenient if you're using, for example, 60 milliliters a day to buy the 10 milliliter ampules, because you don't have to break so many ampules and keep injecting yourself to get to 60 milliliters. On the other hand, if you plan to do some kind of maintenance dose, like 2 milliliters twice a week or something like that, which is effective, you may want the 2 milliliter ampules. Why? Because cerebrolysin, I've learned this through personal experience, oxidizes extremely quickly when exposed to air, of course, and also as the temperature rises. So you always keep your cerebrolysin in the fridge when it's in the ampules. Once you open the ampule, you have to use whatever's in it. Otherwise, that stuff goes to the trash. I've learned this through trial and error personally. Now let me give you some tips from my personal extensive experience using Cerebrolysin that may save you some time and may make your whole procedure more effective. The first thing you'll need is, in addition to buying Cerebrolysin, you'll need a needle and a syringe to be able to inject it. It has to be injected. It does not have to be injected IV. It can and is often frequently injected intramuscularly in studies, and it works perfectly fine when done so. The issue is that you can't really use a normal syringe because you may have to inject a large volume. What I like to do is I go to healthwarehouse.com and I like to buy myself a 5 milliliter syringe that is attached to a needle that's quite big, like a needle that's between the, say, the size of 18 to 22. A big needle makes it easier to withdraw the solution from the ampule initially. However, when I inject the solution into myself, I am not very fond at all of big injections in certain areas with big needles. Number one, needles hurt. They damage the muscle. I mean, the hurt is not the issue for me personally, but the damage of the muscle is really concerning. You don't want to be injecting yourself with a big needle multiple times a week for a long time. You know, it's not a good idea. So what I like to do to make everything easier is I just get my 5 milliliter syringe with an 18 to 22 gauge needle, and then I buy separate needles on healthwarehouse.com, 1 inch long needles that are like between 28 to 30, 31 gauge, meaning they're thinner needles. So all you do is take the big 5 milliliter syringe, open your ampule, take in the 5 milliliters, or if you have a 10 milliliter ampule, you may need 2 syringes, or you may need to do it twice, but you withdraw the fluid, and then you just change the needle at the end and put the smaller needle in, which is sort of an insulin needle. And then with that smaller needle, it's very easy to inject. What I like to do is I inject around my chest. I don't have as much fat here. It's much easier for me than reaching for my shoulder and having to move the needle and stuff like that. I don't like to inject in my shoulder. I've never really done it in my life, maybe twice. So I inject around my actual chest, on the inner chest, around here, where there's low fat, and it's quite easy to get inside the muscle with a small needle. I also, to be honest with you, also inject in my neck and in my trap because I like to be a little bit closer to the head. I believe that Cerebrolysin has a local effect from my experience, and personally I have a bit of a tremor in my neck, so I often inject it in the neck. This has nothing to do with why my neck is a little bit wider recently, but anyway, so I like to inject it closer to there. And what I like to do, honestly, is usually I don't inject 5 milliliters at a time. I'll inject like 2.5 milliliters and then move 1 inch away and go back in with the same needle and inject the rest of it. And then if I'm injecting like 10 milliliters, I'll go back, take the needle off, put the other needle back in, take 5 milliliters from another ampule, or if it's the same ampule, I'll take the other 5 milliliters, and then I'll go switch the needle again and inject again, maybe on the same pack, or maybe on the other pack, or maybe on the neck, and so on. Now, what about protocols? So I've actually never personally used more than 10 milliliters at a time, although obviously there are many studies using up to 60 milliliters a day. I believe that if I were to go through opiate withdrawal, I would be using between 10 to 60 milliliters a day for at least 10 days, followed by some kind of maintenance regimen. Now, for those of you that are thinking of what kind of protocol should I use, go to my blog post. I've written the exact doses used in all of the studies intentionally so that you could see them and reflect on them and use them for your own protocols that you develop. But here are my thoughts. If I was going through opiate withdrawal, I would be using between 10 and 60. I would honestly be using more than 10 a day. Now, if I'm going through depression or anxiety that's short term, it may be something like that, followed by a maintenance schedule. Talking about maintenance schedules, 2 milliliters twice a week is significant. 2 milliliters once a week, I don't really believe is that significant for most people. Also, some people like to inject a large dose once a week. The reason is, by the way, if you inject a large dose, and even if you inject a bit of a small dose, when you have more growth factors in your brain, you'll be a little bit foggy brain the next day. So if you inject 10 milliliters today, you may be a little bit foggy brain tomorrow. So some people can't afford to be foggy brain more than once a week, so they'll inject it all in 1 week. And that works because, as we can see from the studies, Cerebrolysin has a trailing effect, especially if you do it more than 1 week in a row, once a week. So there's a lot of different protocols you could use. You could experiment around. I bet you guys you'll find that Cerebrolysin is one of the most powerful tools that you've ever encountered for your own mental health, biohacking. It's really just such a wonderful tool. It acutely alleviates anxiety. Not as much depression, but particularly anxiety, has a calming effect. Oh, by the way, if you combine growth hormone injection with Cerebrolysin the same day, it potentiates the Cerebrolysin effect significantly. Quite significantly. In fact, I experimented with this a couple of times since I hurt my finger and I used a little bit of growth hormone. I tried to combine it with the Cerebrolysin. Incredible effects. So anyway, you guys will find that Cerebrolysin is a very useful tool. Basically, everything I used to say about SSRIs being wonderful sort of applies to Cerebrolysin. The difference is Cerebrolysin does not cause any sexual dysfunction and works immediately. And it works better the longer you use it, but it works immediately. And if anyone ever wants to know what it feels like to be on a high-dose SSRI, you could inject 10 milliliters of cerebrolysin tonight and know the feeling tomorrow. It's really quite interesting. It's a powerful tool. Come back here and comment on the video after you've tried it. Tell us of your experiences. Don't hate on it if it didn't work for you. It works for a lot of people. I already know that for sure. And if it didn't work for you, for example, say you're a heroin addict going through withdrawal and using 5 milliliters a day for 10 days, maybe you were supposed to use the 60 milliliters, right? So experiment a little bit, see how it works for you. Let us know in the comment section below. And I hope you guys appreciated this video. If you did, please let me know below as well. Thank you so much for bearing with me, and I'll see you again next time.